So if you're making a program and you need some data from a database, in a conventional sense, what you'll be writing is SQL queries, and you'll be using some kind of database driver to communicate with the database. So then you'll get a SQL result back to the program. And now it is up to the program to take that result and then transform it into some kind of tangible object that the programming language knows how to use. So let's say you have some kind of table and there is a column with an ID. Well, ID for a C# program might be an integer, but maybe the database doesn't use integers. Maybe it uses something called numeric or serial. Maybe you have something called name, and maybe name would be a string in your C# or Java program or whatever. But that's not the case with the database. Maybe the database uses something called varchar, and maybe it uses something called text. So we need to actually map the native types of the database to the native types of the programming language. And there's a lot of work that just goes into taking types from one place and then transforming it into types from another place. When you're actually taking all of these results from the database and turning it into objects in a program, you will naturally also use the construct within a programming language, like an array or a list or something like that, which means that a number of rows in a result set will be turned into a list of objects. So there's a lot of translating concepts going from relational database outputs into programming language constructs. And of course, if you can deterministically decide what to transform here into here, and also the other way around, well, then naturally someone will build a tool that does that. And exactly that is what a big part of an object-relational mapper is. So today we're going to look at an object-relational mapper, and it's called Entity Framework, and it's for C#. So I have a folder where I keep all of my source code, and I'll just create an empty directory here, efdemo, and then I'll go into efdemo here, and then I'll create a new empty solution, .NET new SLN. And then I'll just open this folder with my IDE. So here I have Writer, and Writer will present me with an empty solution. So I'll start off by just adding a project here, and I'm going to pick class library, and then I'm going to write data access. This is going to be the project that is responsible for actually using Entity Framework. And now I'm going to also add another project on top of this, and I'm going to just call it API. So this is just to demonstrate a use case where I'm using Entity Framework. If you want to do this with a CLI and you maybe don't use Writer, you can always just use the command .NET new web to create an API, or .NET new class lib to create a class library for the data access layer. So in order to actually use Entity Framework, we need to add a dependency to it. So I'll go into managing the NuGet packages here, and here I'll just search for entity, and it should be one of the first appearances. And I'll add this to data access. So currently my head blocks this button, but there's a little button here next to data access where you can create plus. If you install it to this project, you could open up the file system overview and then find the project file, and you should be able to see that you have Entity Framework installed. So the way Entity Framework works is that you need a context class, and the context class is an abstraction for your database, and you'll use this when you want to interact with your database. So if I make a class here and I call it myDbContext, and I then extend DbContext as a class, see this one comes from Entity Framework. Now we can start filling in some stuff into the DbContext here. So the first thing we need to add is a constructor here. So I'll write public myDbContext, and then I want to take in a DbContext options object here. And I want to use my own class here as generic type, my DB context, and I can just call this one options. And I can make a scope already, but what I'm going to do here is use this little colon here and write base, and then I use options here. So this actually calls the constructor within the superclass, which is the DB context class. The reasoning for this funny syntax is because when we need to connect to a database, we actually don't specify the connection from in here. We want to specify the connection from within our API, and then the API uses the DB context. And currently, we don't have a database. But the neat thing about Entity Framework is you can actually create a database schema based on what you define here in your context. So if you define what they call a DB set, that will represent a table in a database. So if you write public DB set here, and you make a model, let's just make something called product, public class products, and put a property in here, public string product name, it set, and you put this generic type in here. So you take product, put it here, and you call it products. This is representing the products table, and this is a property, so we'll also add accesses here to the products property. Like I mentioned before, we need to actually add the injection for our database somewhere else. So we go into the program.cs file here, and this is how your program.cs file will look by default, depending on whether or not you specify top-level statements. So within this file, which actually starts the program, is where we also need to inject the database context such that other parts of the program can use it. And in order to do that, we need to actually start adding a reference from the API to the data access layer, because currently, even though they are within the same solution, there is no direct knowledge from the API to the data access. But now that we have that, we can use the methods within the data access. So if I write builder services add DB context here, I actually get to put in my own DB context within these diamond brackets here. And now we need to specify how to connect to the database and the options that govern the database context. So recall that we're using this options here, and we're calling the constructor in the superclass. Well, these options are the options that we're going to put in here. So first of all, we need to figure out where is this database. The simplest conceivable way of connecting to a database is to go into a file system and then make a file somewhere, like inside the data access layer, and call it mydatabase.db. And now you go into your NuGet package manager and you search for entity and then SQLite. And now you take this one and you add it to the data access layer. So this is a particular DBMS that is specialized in being extremely lightweight, and it only requires you to have a file. So you don't actually need a distributed database system, you just need a file. So this is fine for demonstrating things and doing things locally, but it's not really meant for production usage. But I'm going to use it in this demo here. And then afterwards, I'm also going to show you how you can set up a more heavyweight database system for this. So inside of the adding of the database context here, you're going to use the options variable we just declared. And then I'm going to write use SQLite. And here it needs to figure out where in the world is this database file. And we just created it within the data access layer. So I'm going to write data source. And now I'm going to write dot dot because I need to go out from this directory. And I'm going to go into data access. And that is capitalized D and capitalized A. mydatabase.db. The database is just an empty file. And what we'd actually like to be able to do is to actually rebuild the database based on the things we put into this context file. So we have a table that should contain this product type here. And one of the constraints that you might also run into is that you should also be defining primary keys for your database. So I'll just define an int here, public int ID, and I want to add accesses here, get it set. If you want to specify that something is a primary key or you want to make some kind of database constraint, you can do it within the context class here. So there is a method inside of DbContext called onModelCreating. I'll write protected override void onModelCreating, which takes in a model builder parameter here. And then we can use the model builder here to specify the primary key for our tables. So I'll use model builder, and then I'll use entity, and then I'll put in with the generics here, products. And now you just chain a method onto this called sKey, and I'll make a little lambda expression, key.p.id. So now that we are totally satisfied with our context, we are ready to actually rebuild the database, which is at this location. So what we're going to do now is go down to the app phase here, just before we map the controllers and just after we call this builder.build call here. I'm going to make a using keyword here and write var scope equals app.services.createScope. Typically, you can access services by just writing app.services get service and then db context and so on. But this would require you having a singleton. And since it's not a singleton, we're going to make a scope in here. And then I'm going to write scope and then service provider and then get service db context. And now this is the actual instance that represents our database at the current point in time. And then we can recreate it by just calling ensure created. You can also delete your database altogether by using something called ensure deleted. But right now it's just an empty file. So we're interested in triggering this one. And by default, you can actually see all the SQL that is created behind the scenes. So when we started up the API, create table command here is actually going to be run. That's why if you open up the .db file from scratch here, then you can actually see that there is a products table. That means we're ready to actually perform some CRUD operations with this database. So we successfully set up a database and we actually are ready to also perform some CRUD operations. But just because I told you before that you can also use different DBMSs, I'm going to just demonstrate this for you really quick. So my preferred database is the one called Postgres. And when I use Postgres locally, I always run it inside of Docker container. So what I do is I make a file called Docker Compose. And inside of this Docker Compose file here, we're going to specify that we need a Postgres container. So it's like having a little virtual machine, and the little virtual machine has a database running inside of it that you can query from your own host system. So you need to have Docker installed for this step. If you don't have that, you can just do everything with the SQLite database that we already have in this file here. But this is just to show that you don't have to do this with SQLite. So YAML is a markup format. So we just insert a document which describes the database that we need. So this is not actually something that's super particular to our program. This is just some boilerplate code that I insert here. And then I get a Postgres database. And the only things that you might want to specify are the names of the database, the password, and the user. Currently, this is just for testing locally. So you don't need to think too much about hard coding a password here. When you actually want to start the database using Docker, you need to have Docker running on your system. You can always check that by just running Docker PS. If you have correctly installed Docker, you should get this up here. And if you have any containers running, you should be able to see them. Currently, I don't have any. And then when you're inside of the directory with the compose file, you can run Docker compose up, and then it will start whatever the YAML file here describes. Means now there is a Postgres database system running inside of a container that I can access through my host system. That means now instead of connecting using the SQLite file that we have specified here, we will now just comment out this line here where it says use SQLite, and then I will write options. And now you need to specify that you will use the Postgres database. But since it's a different DBMS, you actually need to add that as a dependency in your data access layer. So if you write Postgres SQL here, and then add this to your data access, you can write use npgsql here. And now you need to specify the connection string. So the most conventional thing to do here is to put your connection string into some kind of settings file and then reference the settings file. So I will just show you the intended way, and that is inside of the app settings.json. Add a little scope here that's just called connection strings, and then give your connection string a name. In my case, I just called it mydbcon, and you're going to specify the server, which is localhost, and then whatever name of the database, user, and password that you specify. By default, this is going to pick 45432, so you don't have to specify that yourself. So the syntax for actually referencing the connection string we just configured into the settings file is builder configuration get connection string. And now whatever name is specified for it, there are more fancy ways of doing configuration than this, but this is just referencing something that you put into a settings file. And that was my DbCon. So let's just go into the API folder and run the API again. And something that you might want to use at some point is to just have a normal database exploration layout. So you can always just use the one built into a writer here. We use the user test user, test pass, test DB, and now we just connect to it. And you can see that there is the test database here. And currently there is the products table. So we already have our database up and running inside of our container. And that's of course, because we're using this ensure created here. So let's try to actually write some queries now. I'll make a product controller here, and then we'll just make some generic CRUD operations. So public action results, get products. Now what we're gonna do is make a constructor here where we require my DB context. And now we'll use this context here to just list all the products. So that would be a context products to list. And then we can just return this along with the status code. So this is already a valid endpoint. We just need to extend controller base in order to actually get knowledge of the OK method. And then we'll just specify that this is an HTTP GET method. And the route here will just be API/products. And then I'll also just make a method for pasting products into the database. So create products, HTTP post. So I'm going to make a product from the body JSON here and just specify that they need to buy a product. And now what I'll do is I'll use my context. And then I'll use the add method here. This is how you insert a new product into the database. It's actually super clean and easy. And then you actually need to write context.saveChanges. And then you can return the product. And I'll just send a status code along with it like this. And before I actually run this, I'll also just add an empty route up here because I appended the API down here. And before we can actually use the controller class, we need to also add the controllers to the program.cs file here. So I'll write builder services add controllers. And now down here, I'll delete that one and app map controllers. So now when we run the API, we should also be able to hit those endpoints. And I'll just add a file here to actually test it. Request.http gets, and now I'll just paste in the address that we specified for getting products. And we get a status code 200, and there's an empty array. That works out because we haven't added anything yet. So I'll make these three hashtags here. So now I'll test the post requests here, and I'll write the content type application JSON, and I'll put in a JSON object here and write product name. And the convention is to use camel case when you actually transmit a JSON object over the web. My product. So let's try and send this here. And what we get back here is the ID and the product. That means that entity framework itself and the database is actually producing the ID for the product, which is also what we expect when we have a primary key for the ID. And if we use this get here, we'll now get an array of the products. So we are successfully producing CRUD operations. So the intended way of querying using entity framework is to actually use their built-in types. So if you want to do something like filtering, you would use the where method here. If you want to join, you would use include and so on and so forth. But let's say that you don't actually want to query using entity frameworks built-in types. You still have the freedom to just write from SQL. And now you just paste in a string here. And then the string becomes your query. And now you can still just take the query and then just map it to a type within your context. So you're not actually locked into using their system. Now I'm just going to rerun the API here and try and just send a get request. And we can still get out our products. And you do have to consider when using raw SQL queries is, now you don't have the power to just move between DBMSs because of the different SQL dialects. So if you use a SQLite, you have to write a SQLite query here. If you use Postgres or Microsoft SQL Server or something else, then this is what you're going with. But if you're using this query syntax to list here, that is completely DBMS agnostic. And all of the different methods that they put into it, like where product, .id equals 1, that is still completely usable, no matter if you migrate the DBMS to something else. Now, just a couple closing remarks about entity framework is, this approach where you write the context yourself and you define your models, that's what we call the code-first approach. The idea here is that if you can produce a database based on your C# code, then you don't have to maintain two things that might end up not being in synchronicity. So renaming things inside of your program should not create problems with your database, and renaming things in your database should not be creating problems with your program. And that's why if you can have one single source of truth for your database, that is better than having to maintain a database and then query it from a program. So that's one of the reasons why having a single source of truth for how the database is supposed to behave is extremely nice for a developer. However, you do have to actually learn the syntax of producing constraints and how these things will be generated into tables. But this is just one approach of doing entity framework. This is the approach called code first, where you first write your C# code and that generates a database. You could also go the other way, where you maybe already have a full database with your tables, that can also create the C# code. And that's what we'll be looking at next time.